With another successful football season in the rearview mirror, Morgantown, West Virginia is now all about basketball. And the main reason is Bob Huggins, who played his college ball for the Mountaineers and began a successful coaching career here as an assistant. Now Huggins is back to lead the program and has West Virginia rolling at 15-4. Tonight, his team goes for its biggest conquest yet. Number 9 Georgetown, and it's star center Roy Hibbert. The Coliseum will be rocking tonight in Morgantown. Welcome inside the Coliseum, where the West Virginia Mountaineers have won 15 straight. It's one of college basketball's most unsung six men. And the sellout crowd ready to blow the roof off this old building as they welcome in ninth-ranked Georgetown. The Hoyas are atop the Big East standings entering tonight at 5-1. Louisville won today, so it's 5-2. West Virginia and three other teams at 4-2 going into tonight. Hi, everybody, alongside Len Elmore. I'm Dave Pash and Lenny. West Virginia perfect at home on the season. 3-0 in conference play here at the Coliseum. And behind us, a big reason why they're so successful here. Why else is it hard for other teams to win here?
Well, I don't know. Maybe it's the mountain streams. But when they're on the road, this team can't find the basket or can't find their men. But at home, they play tenacious D and they shoot the lights out against the Georgetown team that is atop the standings, probably the best road team in the conference. They're going to have to be that home team that we've seen so far.
Meanwhile, Georgetown, a team that's played well on the road this year, and Roy Hibbert is a big reason why he's featured in our Star Watch along with Alex Ruoff.
Well, Roy Hibbert, top 5 in conference field goal percentage in blocks. And Alex Ruoff, double-double last game, averaging almost 6 assists in the last 3 games.
Let's take a look at the rest of the starting lineups for Georgetown and West Virginia. The Hoyas have won 7 out of their last 8. 5-1 in conference play coming into tonight. Wallace, Sapp, and Austin Freeman in the backcourt. Freeman, the number 2 scorer for Georgetown in Big East games. Roy Hibbert, their leading scorer, along with sophomore Dewan Summers. And for West Virginia, winners of 4 in a row coming into this game here tonight. Alex Ruoff and Darris Nichols in the backcourt. Jamie Smalligan played just 2 minutes against Marshall, but to start again tonight. John Flowers, his 3rd straight start. And Da'Sean Butler with a game-winning shot against Marshall with 6 seconds remaining. Ed Corbett at Hightower, Pat Driscoll, our officials, as we're ready for basketball on a Saturday night. Bob Huggins' hometown, a Morgantown native and a 1977 West Virginia graduate in his first season here. Got his 600th career win back on December 22nd against Canisius. And Jonathan Wallace will start with the basketball in his hands for the Hoyas.
And West Virginia will start in a man-to-man. Jamie Smalligan given the huge task of playing Roy Hibbert one-on-one. And right away, you can see he's going to try to play him as physically as he possibly can.
And a foul inside as Hibbert collides with Smalligan. That's the first foul in the game. John Thompson, the 3rd. Won the Big East last year and went to the Final 4. Done a great job turning around this program. It was down a bit after Craig Escherich's tenure here. Following John Thompson III's father, John Thompson Jr., as Jonathan Wallace hangs and scores for the game's first basket.
Well, Georgetown, obviously the type of team that loves to pass you and backdoor you to death. Also has the ability to take you off the bounce, as you saw with Wallace, and in man-to-man here, Georgetown, one of the best in the country, if not the best, in field goal percentage D.
Hibbert with a block, but West Virginia maintains possession, and the 3 was way off. Flowers is there, though, and Hibbert appeared to get a piece of that shot. Freeman in transition finds Summers, and it's 4-0 Georgetown.
You know, we talk about Georgetown's defense, and even though you saw some shot blocking there, they're not a tremendous shot blocking team. They only average about 4 blocks a game. But they will get down and play you. They will come over and help take the position away, make it really tough on an offense, particularly one that likes to run its patterns.
Georgetown, not a good rebounding team either. Minus 10 the other night in an overtime win against Syracuse. Georgetown does lead the nation in field goal percentage defense, 3rd in the country in field goal percentage on offense. Shot clock at 5 for Ruoff. West Virginia with 1 on the timer, bailed out by A foul up top on Summers as he hacked Nichols from behind the arc. And three free throws coming up. Only one team has scored over 70 points in the last six games that they've met, so you can expect another defensive game here tonight.
Well, it's the changing defenses really that force both teams to kind of slow the tempo down. In the past, West Virginia would go man, they'd go 2-3 zone, they'd go 1-3-1 zone. Really change it up on you. And Georgetown playing a tough man-to-man would mix in some zone as well.
Joe Alexander has just come into the game and was going to replace John Flowers, but they're not going to let him come in yet. They had already given the ball to Nichols. He was ready for his free throw. Alexander's been battling a groin injury, did not play against South Florida two games ago, and then came back against Marshall, came off the bench and played 25 minutes and had 9 points. And the crowd here in Morgantown certainly happy that he's able to go. He's their second leading scorer and one of the top rebounders for this West Virginia squad. And only one out of three there at the free throw line for Nichols, a 74% foul shooter. West Virginia against Marshall the other night was 11 of 28 from the line and still won.
Wow.
Funny, they were 6 of 21 in the second half. Beautiful move there by Roy Hibbert for his first basket.
That's old school big man move, the swing and hook, baseline sky hook, call it whatever you want. But a guy Roy Hibbert's size, if he can master that shot, that's his go-to shot. He can be relatively unstoppable if he hits.
So is Alex Ruoff. If he gets it going from behind the arc, the first field goal of the game for West Virginia, but Georgetown is right back down the court. And Summers with a couple of transition scores.
Well, it's no secret, Georgetown, probably the best team in the Big East thus far and the best road team, and they do it because they're intelligent, they got good size, they're quick, and most of all, they've got experience. They know what it's like to go into this Lions den and to be able to play their game.
Georgetown 4-4 for the field so far, and now a foul on Wallace, his first and the second on the Hoyas.
We take a look at Roy Hibbert. Look how far out Smalligan has pushed him, but Hibbert, with some mobility, puts it on the floor to get himself in position, and shades of Kareem Abdul-Jabbar or even Lou Alcindor at UCLA.
Stop being modest. If there was a snapshot from 1982, it'd be Len Elmore, right?
That's getting a little bit older. I used to have that shot.
Well, we might get to see it a little bit later. Len Elmore was on the court, warming up with the Georgetown Hoyas before the game, and maybe we'll get a look at that later on.
I mean, I don't see why guys, they have the jump hook, but that swinging hook, when there's no help to the baseline, it gets you balanced and either provides you with an opportunity to shoot a pretty good touch. Guys should be shooting more.
Butler is off the mark from three. He's a 46% three-point shooter. West Virginia, like last year, one of the best teams in the Big East in terms of threes. They lead the conference in made threes. And a steal by Ruoff.
That time Jessie Sapp telegraphed the back door. Ruoff, we talked about his intelligence. Reads the scouting reports, watches the video. He got his hands up. And speaking of a guy that's starting to really assert himself, Jamie Smalligan in this game has to do that.
He had only made 5 threes in 38 attempts on the year prior to that. And that's got to be a huge confidence builder for a guy that was benched after last game. Alexander with the block. And West Virginia looking to take the lead on this possession.
Well, you talk about Smalligan's shooting percentage from beyond the arc. He's a better shooter than that. I think that once you start missing, it kind of weighs on you. He's got to throw that out from the left.
Last year, shot 46% from three-point land. And John Beilein was the head coach. Doesn't have the confidence that he did last year, but Bob Huggins trying to get that out of him. And he said, he told us today, he thought Smalligan was going to have a big game against Roy Hibbert, as Sapp is called for his first personal and the third team foul on Georgetown. Now, when we come back, we'll talk about a special West Virginia fan. Back to Morgantown in a moment.
ESPN's exclusive presentation of college basketball is brought to you by Applebee's. Together is good. And EAS. Don't waste your workout.
West Virginia down one, but off to a good start from behind the arc at 50% from three here in the early going. And that has to please one of West Virginia's biggest fans, Carrie Coastman, who comes to all the games, Len. She is blind and deaf in one ear, has 80% hearing loss in her other ear, but she listens to Tony Caridi and Jay Jacobs, the West Virginia radio team, to every game. She even went to the game against Marshall down in Charleston the other night. She is a freshman here at West Virginia, wants to be a sports writer. I had a chance to talk to her before the game, and she is a diehard West Virginia football and basketball fan. She was here for the women's game as well today, watching the Mountaineers beat Georgetown and women's basketball as well.
Wow, that is definitely a fan. And you know, it's such a great story. This game, all the games, and more than just X's and O's and scores. You know, these things make a difference in people's lives. And, you know, we all should be cognizant of that when we start getting mad at our home team or our favorite team if they don't accomplish things. It's still just a game.
Georgetown 4-5 from the field. 4 points in transition. That's right now the difference in the game, but West Virginia has defended Georgetown better the last couple of times down court.
And there's Georgetown going to zone, looking to extend, double in the corners.
And shot clock's at 4. Nichols got to get it up there. And it's a shot clock violation. And that's happened twice now, although Bob Huggins' team got bailed out the first time on a Georgetown foul, but it didn't hurt him as Nichols was just one of three at the foul line.
And we mentioned it earlier when you brought up the point about low scoring games. Only once has any team cracked 70 in a while. These are the reasons why. The changing defenses, a little surprise, forcing teams to really think about what they're doing. And that'll slow the tempo.
Patrick Ewing Jr. into the game. He's got the ball, finds Jessie Sapp. A little bit off balance as he pulled the trigger there, and a Georgetown foul that's going to get called on Hibbert. That's his first and the fourth on Georgetown. Now John Thompson III's defense right now perhaps the best in college basketball. The stats back it up. Look at that.
And again, they do it without being a major shot blocking team, although I think that Roy Hibbert in the middle with his size and his extension is certainly a deterrent. And that's even better than actually blocking the shots. But these guys get down and they play you. Good fundamentals. As I said, they take position away.
And it's really not a surprise to see Hibbert on the bench. He only averages about 26 minutes per game. Played a season high 37 on Monday night. Granted, that game went to overtime against Syracuse. Nice pass by Alexander, and Da'Sean Butler with the basket to give West Virginia the lead.
Well, a good two-man game. Alexander posting up knowing he's going to get doubled because he had a size advantage. And his first look was to find, okay, who's open.
And the Hoyas turn it over on the other end. Second giveaway by Georgetown.
Take a look at Alexander posting up strong. Got the size advantage. Here comes the help right here. And Butler. Where he belongs.
West Virginia's won 15 straight here at home. Georgetown, one of only two teams in the Big East with an above 500 road record in conference games.
Georgetown and man switching a lot. It could be considered a matchup because you do get some mismatches out there.
Nichols for three. West Virginia's third triple already.
Well, Bob Huggins told us before the game at practice today that they just need to shoot it well. On the road, really can't find a basket, about 33% in three conference road games and 24% from beyond the arc. But at home, 46% from the field and 43% from beyond the arc in three home games in conference. Nothing like home cooking, huh?
And good defense there by Flowers, blustering Ewing. Now, so far, West Virginia 3-5 from behind the arc. We mentioned they lead the conference in made threes. And Bob Huggins says because they shoot better at home, that makes their defense better. He says sometimes when you don't shoot well, you don't really want to play hard defense.
Still thinking about that missed shot.
Eight straight points for West Virginia. Mountaineers lead by 4 on ninth-ranked Georgetown. Already a top 10 team loss today. Indiana fell at home to UConn. High archer by Butler wouldn't drop, and here comes Austin Freeman. Jeremiah Rivers off the mark from 3, but a foul inside on West Virginia, and Alexander is first and the second on the Mountaineers. Winter X Games 12 continues on ESPN tonight with more action on the slopes. Catch Sean White in the snowboard superpipe men's elimination. Tucker Hibbert, no relation to Roy, in the snowmobile snowcross final in the snowboard big air final. That's your favorite, Lenny. Winner X Games 12 at ESPN later tonight. Do you want your jaw to drop for 2 hours straight? Watch X Games.
Well, you talk about Sean White, the redhead, king of the superpipe. Lost his top spot last year. Got a little rivalry going out there with a couple of guys.
Tough shot by Freeman. Georgetown's gone 5.5 minutes without a point. West Virginia on an 8-0 run. Joe Mazzulla now running the point for West Virginia. Flowers from the corner. Unable to knock down the triple, and now Rivers looking to push the tempo. Rivers played well the other night against Syracuse, especially in the defensive end. Also at 6 points in 22 minutes. Wallace tried to feed the post and turned it over. That's not the way to get it into the lane. Len Elmore knows how, though. He's going to tell us how to feed the post when we come back to Morgantown. West Virginia by 4 over Roy Hibbert in Georgetown. West Virginia leads number 9 Georgetown by 4. The Hoyas turned it over on their last possession. They couldn't feed the post. Len Elmore will show us how.
Feeding the post is a lost start, and it all begins with the passer. Many passers have to practice their art, and what it begins with is getting in triple threat position to be able to get a 45-degree angle, although you should be able to feed the post from just about any angle. It begins with looking, being able to fake down if you're going to throw it up, or to be able to fake up if you're going to throw down. You have to want to be able to feed the post. As a receiver, you have to get yourself in position. You never want your toes to be parallel. You want to be able to lock the defender on your hip. Now, with two hands, you're demanding the ball, giving the passer a target. And once you give him a target, if it's here, you go after it with two hands. Well, normally you take about a half hour to show that. Look at the pass right there. One hand didn't present himself. And even though the passer delivered it properly, you got to go after the ball with two hands. Reaching with one hand is going to allow the defender a chance to step in, deflect. You reach with two hands, you're meeting the ball, and you prevent the defender from getting between you and the ball.
Many of your former teammates, I don't think, knew that you knew how to feed the post there.
Oh, I knew how to feed the post, and I had to actually instruct a lot of our guys how to give me the ball.
And Georgetown not been able to put it in the hoop over the last 6 minutes. 8 possessions, 3 turnovers, 0 for 5 in a 8-0 West Virginia run. 4-point Mountaineer lead.
I'll tell you, the one guy on this floor that understands that whole art is Roy Hibbert. He's done throughout his career a terrific job of being able to present himself and demand the ball and catch with two hands.
Nice move there by Alexander. A very talented 6'8" junior. 15.6 rebounds per game on the season for him.
Doesn't show any ill effects from that groin injury. And he's still moving very swiftly. Got that elevation.
Here's Macklin, and he turned it over. Fourth Georgetown turnover. They started 4 for 4 from the field, and they've missed 5 straight shots. Mountaineers almost give it away on the other end, and now they do. Mazzulla turned it over as he was on his back. Here's Rivers in the front court. Vernon Macklin off the window. Macklin a 10 at Pittsburgh in relief of Roy Hibbert a couple weeks ago. A loss for Georgetown. Its only loss in Big East play.
Much better job that time. Nice delivery by Wallace inside to the big fellas. When you play for a team like Georgetown that has very talented big guys, you better know how to feed the post. You better know when. And when they ask for it, you better give it to them.
Ruoff was asking for it that time. He couldn't hit the shot, but a Georgetown foul. And that'll be the 5th team foul on the Hoyas. Alex Ruoff, the leading scorer for West Virginia this year. Everybody shoots well on this Mountaineer team.
And primarily shooting well at home, as we mentioned. On the road, in conference play, it's been a bit of a different story. But they shoot well because they know what makes them successful. Very few times will you see guys from West Virginia do more than they're capable of doing, and they play with each other. They move the ball, they find a way to get it to guys that are open where they can do something with it.
Foul on Ewing is first, 15th foul on Georgetown. Only two team fouls on West Virginia. Midway through the first half, 4-point Mountaineer lead.
There's the Georgetown zone once again. Nice job on the strip by Rivers, even though Alexander has about 7 inches on him.
Now Rivers did a good job on Johnny Flynn in overtime for Syracuse, keeping Flynn from hitting a long three and giving Georgetown a win in overtime on Monday night. Rivers had good defense on Alexander last time down the floor. Now they got Summers on Alexander. Smalligan hit a three earlier, but way off with that one. Wanted a foul, but no call. Well, you mentioned Big Monday last week featured Georgetown at Syracuse. This week, as part of Student Spirit Week, we've got Louisville and Connecticut. UConn coming off a big win today at Indiana, followed by Oklahoma State and Oklahoma at 9 Eastern time. And you wonder, with Jim Calhoun having to suspend two players, Jerome Dyson and Doug Wiggins, indefinitely, that actually could be favorable for UConn as Sapp hits a three.
Well, UConn had certainly was focused today. Even though they went down, they came back as a team and down the stretch hit some key free throws, something that, you know, UConn hasn't been able to find in the past couple of games, and maybe in the past year and a half, hitting key free throws down the stretch to win close games.
Indiana was ranked 8th in the country. So big win for Jim Calhoun. Ruoff off the mark from three. Ewing got the rebound and then a foul called on West Virginia. That's the third team foul on the Mountaineers. And the second personal on Joe Alexander.
Well, Alexander can't play tentatively under the basket with Georgetown. First, you got to get good position, but then after that, you can't back down. Georgetown guys are tough and are motivated. You talk about them not being a great rebounding team, but, you know, they have their stretches where they really clean the board and dominate.
Georgetown started 4-4, but struggling from the field since. Another miss as Wallace was way off of that shot. And Pat. Georgetown just 2 of its last 9. And you saw Bob Huggins there, as we mentioned at the top of the telecast. He is a West Virginia graduate, Morgantown native, loves being home. And that's why he said he left Kansas State after 1 year. It was a dream opportunity to come back to Morgantown and coach at WVU.
You see him walking around this facility, and even outside, boy, treating him like the mayor of Morgantown, maybe the governor of West Virginia.
Foul on the inside as Butler couldn't put it in, but it'll go to the line for 2. 16 fouls now on Georgetown, and they get Tyler Crawford for the personal, his first. Da'Sean Butler over his last 3 games, averaging 17 points per contest. Had a fine freshman season. And added again this year at 18 against Marshall the other night, including the game winner with 6 seconds left.
And really, over the last 4 games, Da'Sean Butler has been the man for West Virginia. He's been a solid presence down low. He's got that mobility when played by bigger guys to be able to take him outside, take him off the bounce. Just an outstanding talent.
Butler, a 64% free throw shooter, gets both. West Virginia back up 3. 8 minutes remaining in the first half. Georgetown has yet to shoot a free throw. First place in the Big East on the line in this game. Georgetown at 5-1. Louisville 5-2. West Virginia 4-2 coming into tonight.
And the Georgetown drought is not coincidental to the fact that they haven't been able to get the ball inside.
Patrick Ewing now 5 of 9 in conference games behind the arc, and he ties the game at 16.
I guess when you knock them down like that, you don't have to worry about going inside the paint. But they had this stretch when they got it in the paint. West Virginia's defense adjusted. Forced Georgetown outside.
Shot clock at 10. Wellington Smith got caught in the lane. Sapp almost took it away. And a foul going to be called with 5 on the shot clock. That's the 17th foul on Georgetown, 2nd on Jonathan Wallace. Well, we mentioned that UConn had a big win today. Highlights of that game on the other side of this break. All right, Scott, and that was not the only upset of a top 15 team. Wisconsin going down at Purdue, a game that you saw on ESPN here in Morgantown. West Virginia trying to make it 3 top 15 teams to lose. Ninth ranked Georgetown with the Mountaineers now down one after that free throw by Wellington Smith. Only a 45% foul shooter. And Hibbert with the rebound.
Well, right now, Georgetown really has to go back and reestablish inside. First 4 minutes of the game, they were able to get 6 quick points inside the paint. Haven't scored in the paint since then. A lot of it has to do with that West Virginia defense, which has changed again, going to that zone.
Freshman Austin Freeman way off with that three-point attempt, and it will go to the Mountaineers. John Thompson's team 5-1 in the Big East. They've won 7 of their last 8 games overall. Their only loss coming at Pittsburgh. Tough to win on the road any year, but seems like especially this year in the Big East, as Butler gets the roll and West Virginia leads by 3.
Well, we saw Da'Sean Butler, probably the hottest hand among the Mountaineers in the last 4 games. And they're starting to understand that well and go to him early and often.
And he's the leading scorer tonight for West Virginia with 6 points. Meanwhile, the Mountaineers are called for their 4th team foul. That's on Smalligan, his 2nd personal.
And it's tough. The coaches on the bench are trying to get Smalligan to understand you don't have to play physical with Roy Hibbert 20 feet away from the basket. You don't want to pick up cheap fouls. Yes, Roy Hibbert can hit some threes. He's already 2 of 2 this year. But in the end, that's not where you want to be able to bump bodies. You want to make sure he doesn't get good position on the low block.
You touched on West Virginia doing a good job in post defense as they tried to hit Hibbert and turned it over. Only 1 shot attempt for Hibbert, and lately he had been more assertive in terms of putting the ball up. There are times last year, remember that game against Villanova at home, he didn't even take an official field goal in that game.
Well, this is one of the things that John Thompson spoke to us about, that if there's any place that his team needs to improve, and that is diversity on the low post. He needs to get more guys, different guys, to be able to post up and get some high percentage looks from down low. Right now, it's just Hibbert, maybe occasionally Macklin, and that's it.
Now, last year, they had Jeff Green, who was very versatile, could play post defense and also on the offensive end. Shot clock down to 3. Nichols in trouble, got it to Smith, and he scores with 1 on the timer.
That's just good old Mountaineer perseverance right there down low. Never gave up on it.
West Virginia now by 5 after Georgetown had tied the game. Both teams under 50% from the field. West Virginia 3 of 7 from 3-point land. 8 points off of Georgetown turnovers for the Mountaineers as Butler is called for his 1st foul.
See, Nichols get himself in all kinds of trouble down low, but he never gave up on it, never panicked because the shot clock was going down. Still made the play.
And Hibbert back to the bench. We mentioned he only plays about 26 minutes per game. He scored in double figures in 5 straight contests, but only 2 points in just 1 shot attempt.
Nice.
Good backdoor by Freeman, and nice feed. That's how you do it, right, Len? Feed in the post?
Well, that was a nice backdoor feed by the postman. Again, Georgetown, rather than go the way of getting a man down on the low block, spreads the floor and starts going backdoor on you. And that's the thing about this Georgetown team. Everybody on this team can pass.
Knocked out of bounds by Georgetown. Big Monday means a full night of college basketball on ESPN, starting with a doubleheader. First at 7 Eastern, a biggie showdown between Louisville and UConn, followed by Bedlam, Oklahoma, and Oklahoma State. Big Monday presented by Bud Light, part of Student Spirit Week, presented by EAS. And here are the Big East standings. At Notre Dame winning today at Villanova to get to 4-2 in league play. West Virginia win would put the Mountaineers, Georgetown, and Louisville all atop the conference at 5-2. Shot clock at 3. Ruoff 4-3. 2nd buzzer beater in a row for the West Virginia Mountaineers.
And the 2nd patience possession, if you will. West Virginia maintaining their poise, knowing what they want to run, and they keep at it until they get what they want. There's a quick post up right now. Can't get it to him, though. Sapp tried. Look inside to Macklin.
Good defense by Butler. Now Sapp forced to put up a 3, but he hits it anyway. Jessie Sapp with his 2nd 3-point basket of the game. Sapp, prior to today, in three career games against West Virginia, had a total of 4 points. He already has 6 here in the first half.
Georgetown back to their matchup. Just got to find a man and play that area that the man is in and forces a long shot. No patience on that possession.
And Wellington Smith missed it. Georgetown with an opportunity to get within one, perhaps tie it with a three, but Macklin turned it over. 6th turnover by Georgetown. Meanwhile, West Virginia, as usual, knocking down threes. They've got 4, including that one there for Alex Ruoff. Mountaineers by 3 at home. All right, Scott, will we see an upset here in Morgantown? West Virginia right now leads number 9 Georgetown by 3. In attendance tonight here in Morgantown is West Virginia new head football coach Bill Stewart, replacing Rich Rodriguez.
Very animated, Coach Stewart.
And there's one of his players, Jared Brown, the backup quarterback, to Pat White. And Stewart encouraging him to play basketball and play pretty well against Marshall the other night, had 5 points. And speaking of Pat White, Stewart says, hey, Pat, if you want to play baseball, go for it. Pat White, pretty good ball player, might practice or even play on the West Virginia baseball team. Mountaineers turn it over there, although spring practice expected to start a little bit late because of the new coaching staff, and that might keep Pat White from playing baseball this year.
Well, on the floor, West Virginia with their 4th turnover. Neither one of these teams will often beat themselves by giving the ball to the other guy. You're only 11 turnovers a game for West Virginia and 12 for Georgetown. But tonight, West Virginia's gotten the best of Georgetown. 6 turnovers for Georgetown, 10 points off those turnovers. And here we go with another opportunity.
Sapp with the brick. Smith on the other end, the hard foul. Jessie Sapp came flying in there to try to block Wellington Smith's shot and committed his 2nd personal foul.
And I think a lot of people get the misperception that, you know, guys are trying to hurt people, but the way these kids leave the floor and get up so high, you know, it makes themselves, they make themselves vulnerable. The ones with the ball make themselves vulnerable to any kind of hit on the ball or anything. And obviously the defender is vulnerable trying to get up in the air and match him. I don't think these guys are trying to hurt each other. It's just that the result of getting so high and making contact, and they got a long way to fall. Take a look at this play right here. Sapp gets ball.
Yeah.
That was a pretty clean block right there.
Yeah. And anybody that knows Jessie Sapp knows that not trying intentionally to hurt anybody. Is Smith missed both free throws anyway?
No, absolutely not. He made a play. He made a defensive play. But I think throughout college basketball, yes, there are times when you see guys go up and act in a malicious fashion. But most of it, people respond to the result instead of understanding why. These guys are above the rim. And they're all vulnerable, so when they hit the ground, it doesn't look good. But it's certainly most of the time not intentional.
Good catch by Hibbert as he was getting bumped. He lost the ball anyway. Still only 1 field goal attempt for Hibbert in the game. Good hands there by Sapp to knock it out of bounds.
Again, another way and throw on the lob. Hibbert sets the screen. The screen is usually open. The pass was okay to a point. It was on the wrong side of the rim if it hadn't been a little closer to Hibbert. But Hibbert, again, went up with both hands. That's the thing that's most impressive of this young man.
Only 2 points, 1 shot attempt. Georgetown has not even attempted a free throw. West Virginia's 4 out of 9. This after going 11 of 28 for an entire game against Marshall. Missed 3 there by Nichols. And cleared by Ewing.
Yeah, the thing about Roy Hibbert, he hasn't played long enough to develop really bad habits. Oh, nice.
How about that spin? Blocking foul. Smalligan blocked the shot. Missoula tried to take the charge and picked up his first personal. 6th on the Mountaineers.
Again, fundamentals. Watch Hibbert sets the screen. Even though it wasn't used, and he's usually the guy that's open because the guy guarding him tries to help. And look at that reverse. Nice job by Smalligan, although I suspect Hibbert would have gotten more elevation but for the block right there. But the big fella showing off some handle.
And the first free throw attempt of the night for Georgetown is good. Hibbert, a 61% free throw shooter. His foul shooting has really improved over the last 5 games. It seems like, Len, the more that we watch him, he gets better each time you see him.
It's because he's a worker, and that's what it comes down to. He continues to work on his game. He's not settling. you know, he's a smart young man and understands that, you know, perfect practice will lead to him developing more and more.
Decided to come back for his senior year. He is a government major and is expected to graduate in May. Talking about Roy Hibbert. Here's Missoula down the lane. Hibbert looked to challenge and that altered the shot of Missoula.
I think Missoula didn't want any part of that. All of a sudden the lights went out as Hibbert stepped in the way.
He rather would have been in Missoula. Glad you got that. John Thompson the third calls a timeout. First one taken by Georgetown, which trails West Virginia by one late in the first half. Number 9 team in the country trailing by one on the road. Georgetown losing to West Virginia late in the first. And a day of upsets in the top 11 in college basketball today, with Indiana ranked 8th losing at home to Kansas, number 11 Wisconsin losing as well. How about Notre Dame winning at Villanova, and Memphis and Kansas continue to roll.
Well, the Irish finally get a win on the road, and Villanova, I mean, you know, you go figure, they had a terrific game up at Syracuse last week.
Yeah.
And then they go to Rutgers and they get blown out, and here at home. I mean, I know Jay Wright's probably tugging at his hair. Hard to figure, but they are small, and in a matchup situation, Notre Dame's so much bigger than they are. Aaron Godey got it started, and Kyle McElarney again just torched Villanova for 30 points.
And you saw that note about Calhoun suspending Jerome Dyson and Doug Wiggins. As Hibbert hits from the outside, that's a two. Hibbert beat Connecticut with a three in a game earlier this season. It's a 7-0 Georgetown run. They lead by one.
Well, you got a chance to see the many sides of Roy Hibbert on offense. His ability to handle the ball and create shots for himself. He can shoot the jumper from 18, 20 feet away. Still needs to post up in this game. That's where he's got his greatest advantage. But with a 7-0 run right now, I wouldn't argue with it.
Ruoff missed the three. Freeman down the lane, no. Hibbert kept it alive. And it's West Virginia ball. The Mountaineers can hold for one. And Bob Huggins will call a timeout. Now we saw Roy Hibbert knock down a long two. He hit a three against Connecticut a couple of weeks ago. Hadn't attempted a three entering this season for his career. Hit one in December and then looked pretty good. His second career made three. Georgetown wins 72-69.
Well, for a guy his size, you know, we're talking about 7'2". He's got outstanding form. And that's the beginning of a good shooter. Good form, good rotation. And then, obviously, I talked about it before, he works. He works so hard. And I think when you project him to the next level, that's the thing that makes coaches salivate. I mean, obviously, at 7'2", with even minimum skills, guys get excited. But a guy like this has tremendous upside. I don't think he's even scratched his potential right now. Yes, he's got to get stronger. We saw a couple of times where he's battled for rebounds that he should have actually dominated. So I think upper body strength is a place that he can improve upon. But, that, you know, you can absolutely do that with a good weight training and conditioning program. But the mentality in his approach to the game, that he has to work to get better and he doesn't mind working, is the thing that I think impresses everyone.
Preseason Big East Player of the Year, the first at Georgetown since Alonzo Mourning, whose career might be done after a knee injury with the Heat, with Mourning saying not so fast, and Hibbert hoping that he can have half the NBA career that Alonzo Mourning has had. 20 seconds remaining in the half. Georgetown leads West Virginia by one. Mountaineers haven't scored in 4 minutes. Georgetown on a 7-0 run.
Well, Johnny West, the son of the great Jerry West, in the game right now. He's a knockdown shooter with tremendous range, looking for penetrate and kick.
5 seconds to go. Here's Butler. Small again with 1 second left. Smalligan's got to shoot. He does. And he hits!
I don't think that was the play. And they're going to have to take a look at the replay. I don't think that was the play. That was not designed for Smalligan to take that shot. But he passed up West wisely because it was defended. And we told you at the beginning of the telecast, Smalligan, even though he came in 5 of 38 shooting the three, He's a better shooter than that. The question is whether he got it off in time. Take a look at the light. No, he did not.
Oh, it's close. Look at the one on the clock there turning to a zero as he releases it. I mean, that is close.
It looks fingertips to me, although I don't have my magnifying glass, and neither do they. So,
I mean, let's watch the clock again. It's turning from one to zero as it leaves his.
It's still in the palm. It's still in the palm.
That angle much better than the other one. But look at this angle here.
Yeah. It's hard to say, though, whether or not it's on fingertips or not. Light goes on. Yep. It doesn't count.
No basket.
I don't know why fans are arguing. The replay doesn't tell tales.
And Georgetown will take a one-point lead into the locker room. 25-24 Hoyas as we go to Scott Reese, Tom Brennan, Doug Gottlieb for the UPS halftime report. Fellas.
Okay, Dave, so instead of a possible two-point lead, you get a one-point deficit. Either way, tight game in West.
Virginia without a point over the final 4 minutes and 40 seconds of the first half. Georgetown goes on a 7-0 run and leads by one as we're ready to start the second half. Good defense on both sides, kind of what we thought.
Well, certainly. I mean, you got Georgetown number one in field goal percentage defense and three-point D, and West Virginia 4 and 5 respectively. So these guys are pitched in a defensive battle. But Roy Hibbert's been probably the difference cookie for Georgetown, shooting 50% from the field. Hibbert 2 of 2, only 2 field goal attempts, but 4 rebounds and 3 blocks. So he's asserted himself on both ends and has been the difference. Let's not forget, West Virginia has missed 5 free throws, which is unusual for them.
Although they did struggle the other night against Marshall, going 11 of 28, but they still won that game. Here's Small again to start the second half. Buries a 3, his second triple of the night. Got that one back. Hit one at the buzzer to end the first half. It was waved off. And that was a good job by the officials after looking at the video replay to see that it was still in his hand, but he gets it right back. And now a West Virginia foul. It's going to go on Small again. That's his third personal.
Well, Roy Hibbert is going to have to come out and guard Small again, even though his shooting percentages tell you not to. But as I mentioned in the first half, he's a better shooter than his numbers tell. And he's going to get a big hand. He's gotten his confidence back, possibly, but he picked up his third foul.
Meanwhile, Hibbert banks it home. He's 3 for 3 from the field. And we're tied at 27. Joe Alexander, by the way, started the second half for West Virginia, did not start the game. He does have 2 fouls and was held at 2 first half points, took only 1 shot.
Well, he's going to be the focal point of this offense because he's got Hibbert guarding him. Alexander much quicker.
Good pass, but Wellington Smith hit the side of the backboard. Summers has it poked away by Smith, but got it back. Sapp with the ball had 6. He, along with Hibbert, led Georgetown in scoring in the first half. Butler and Ruoff with 6 apiece to lead West Virginia in the first. Wallace held to just 2 first half points. And now a Georgetown foul on Freeman, his first and the first on Georgetown in the second half. Big Monday means a full night of college basketball on ESPN starting in the Big East. Louisville taking on Connecticut. Louisville right now in second place in the conference at 5-2. And Oklahoma State, Oklahoma to follow in the Big 12 rivalry game known as Bedlam, all part of Student Spirit Week presented by EAS on ESPN. And Connecticut with a big win today at number 8 Indiana. Louisville beat St. John, so the Cardinals are 5-2 in conference play. Nichols trying to get the Mountaineers to 5-2 in the league. It's the 3, and West Virginia back up 3. His second triple of the game.
Well, West Virginia right now being able to spread the floor a little bit, get some isolation situations. Georgetown defenders not willing to step out.
Hibbert with the backdoor feed to Sapp, but he stepped down the baseline.
Talked about Small again being able to hit the 3. Defenders late on Nichols. Got to be able to step up now. These guys are hot and they start to feel it out there. Be a long second half for the Hoyas.
6-3 for West Virginia. Mountaineers lead the league in made threes per game, but they get an easy 2. Here is Ruoff, makes it a 5-point WVU lead.
That spread floor gives West Virginia opportunities for cuts to the basket, pretty similar to the way Georgetown plays.
Remember, West Virginia on an 8-2 run, but didn't have a point for about 5 minutes towards the end of the first half. Pat Driscoll and Ed Corbett. Hibbert posting up, maybe a push off, but no call, but they get the offensive foul anyway. Second personal on Roy Hibbert. Second on Georgetown.
Well, West Virginia with that spread offense, and you take a look right here, Ruoff comes up, and then whoops, goes back door, the middle wide open. You look at the paint, nobody there. And Georgetown recognizing that in a man situation, they're vulnerable, have gone to that matchup zone again. Starts out as a 2-3, but they match up with guys in their vicinity.
Nice high bank shot. Da'Sean Butler, coming off an 18-point game against Marshall, has 8 in this one as the Hoyas turn it over.
Well, West Virginia very efficient at capitalizing off turnovers. Take a look right here, just a straight post up. This is what you do when you shoot over the mountaintop. And Da'Sean Butler drawing range, that high arcing shot. You know how we coming, get out
our way. All right, Sal, looking forward to it. Got a good one here in Morgantown with West Virginia leading by 7. It has been a season of upsets in the Big East so far. Cincinnati off to a great start, knocked off number 16 Pittsburgh last week. Seton Hall with a big win over Louisville. Connecticut taking care of number 13 Marquette last Sunday. And tonight, Rutgers winning at Pitt by 13. And we were talking with John Thompson III about this tight conference, and he said, you know, even if we win tonight and go to 6-1, still don't think that's a lot of separation. He thinks that the Big East will be jumbled until the end of the regular season.
Well, that Rutgers win all the more impressive because it was at the Peterson Events Center, where, you know, the losses by Pittsburgh, rare as hen's teeth.
Here's Ruoff. That's not rare. Alex Ruoff, one of the best three-point shooters in the Big East, makes it a 10-point game.
And that run has been helped by Georgetown's inability to hold on to the basketball.
Ten straight Mountaineer points. Now last year, this is where a guy like Jeff Green would step up on the road. Who's it going to be for Georgetown now? Here without Green, it was the fifth pick in the NBA draft. Sapp on the drive, and he draws the foul with 4 to shoot.
Well, it looks as though Jessie Sapp is the guy who has to assert himself. And in situations like this, even though you have to stay within your game plan, stay within your strategy, there are times when you need a guy that's going to step up and take over. As you mentioned, last year it was Jeff Green who had that ability. Sapp with the isolation. And he felt that that was upon his shoulders, and at least he got to the free throw line.
Sapp, 75% foul shooter. Ruoff commits his first foul, second on West Virginia, as Ewing returns for Georgetown, replacing Austin Freeman.
And sometimes when you see guys who shoot as well on the season as Jesse Sapp missed that badly, you almost wonder, is he just putting it up there because he's tired or what? But you can't afford to miss that badly. You can't afford to miss it all at this point in time if you're Georgetown. Every point is precious because you're not getting anything out of your offense.
Georgetown is 15th in the Big East in foul shooting, but they're 6th in conference games. They have picked it up since league play started.
Again, the matchup zone, West Virginia's maintaining that spread, good spacing.
Oh, Flowers has it swatted in a major way by Roy Hibbert.
John Flowers from D.C., he ought to know better. I'm sure he's played against these guys before.
I think Tucker Hibbert, who's ready to participate in X Games, will be appreciative of what Roy Hibbert just did with that block shot. No relation, of course. I shouldn't say of course. Maybe Roy likes to snowboard. Out of bounds, last touch by Georgetown. West Virginia with three second-half threes. Ruoff has three threes in the game. And a game-high 11 points. Mountaineers by nine. Well, and already a top 10 team loss in Indiana. Georgetown trails West Virginia by nine. Washington State coming off a loss to Arizona. Will Washington State remain in Len's Power 10?
Well, let's see how the game turns out first.
We'll see how this one turns out, too, to see if Georgetown is in your Power 10. Points up turnover is a big story. West Virginia 17-2 over Georgetown today.
Well, they've been very efficient. West Virginia doesn't turn it over much. Georgetown only 12 turnovers per game, but today 10 so far. And in the second half, three Georgetown turnovers leads to seven West Virginia points. And that's what I was mentioning or referring to when I said Georgetown's inability to hang on to the ball has really got them in this hole here in the second half.
Georgetown has only one field goal in the second half. West Virginia is 5 of 9 from the field. Shot clock at 10. Here's Nick working on Rivers. Alexander with three to shoot. And it'll be West Virginia ball with one on the shot clock.
That time, West Virginia just going east-west.
Ruoff couldn't get it off. He was getting challenged by Ewing. And it's a shot clock violation. Good defense by Patrick Ewing Jr.
That was a tremendous close. Again, looks as though somebody's paying attention to the scouting report. Patrick Ewing Jr. almost clairvoyant on that one. He got to that spot almost before Ruoff did. Yeah.
Georgetown, no points in the last 4:43 and only two attempts.
Well, that's because they've been turning the ball over.
They've got 10 turnovers tonight. You got to guard Hibbert out there now. Hit one tonight, long two, hit a three to beat Connecticut.
Put it on the floor and drove to the basket earlier today.
Summers misses, Hibbert with the rebound. Alexander going to get called for his third foul in the third on West Virginia in the half.
Boy, that is huge. Joe Alexander with the mismatch on his offensive end, but the victim of it on the defensive end. And look at Hibbert just obscuring Alexander. Alexander didn't really block Hibbert out with any authority. Yes, he got his body in the way, but you need to block the big fella out with more authority. Make him feel you and make him back away from you. As Hibbert just held his ground.
Hibbert's free throw shooting improving with every game. He's 3 for 3 tonight. 61% on the year, but it's really picked up over the last five games as Alexander will go to the bench with three fouls and only 2 points. Four blocks, 9 points, seven rebounds for Hibbert. And the senior gets them both. It's a 7-point game. Austin Freeman back in for Georgetown, and Hibbert will get a breather.
Well, Hibbert with two personal fouls. Obviously, conditioning is somewhat of a factor, but I think John Thompson also doesn't want Hibbert to pick up any unnecessary fouls so he can stick around if this thing gets close down the stretch.
Smalling into the bench for West Virginia. And again, with regard to Hibbert's playing time, he averages about 26 minutes per game. So it's not a surprise to see him getting a breather early here in the second half.
Also a little bit of a chess match. Smalling comes in briefly. Hibbert goes out. Bob Huggins takes Smalling out to try to match up. So neither one of these guys wants to play against the other guy. Smalling takes Hibbert too far away from the basket.
And you got Jawan Summers basically is the number five man out there right now at State, trying to guard Alex Ruoff, and Ruoff took him to the basket. Flowers tangled up with Summers. Flowers called for his first, fourth on West Virginia in the half.
We talk about that chess match again, trying to get the best matchup. And right there, you see the quickness of Ruoff just turning Summers around almost in circles as he goes to the basket. West Virginia does a very good job, particularly in spreading the floor in a man situation and finding that mismatch and exploiting.
Wallace, tough shot. Jonathan Wallace, who leads all Division I active players in career starts, making his 120th tonight. Former walk-on John Thompson says he's really tired of that story because he thinks Wallace is one of the best guards in the country. Even though he's an ex-walk-on, as a foul is called on Georgetown. Wallace recently accepted into Georgetown Law School. He's not the first. Georgetown great. Paul Tagliabue averaged almost a double-double, but he spurned the Hoyas for law school then and went to NYU. What will Jonathan Wallace do?
I got a feeling Jonathan Wallace is going to take that acceptance. He might defer it a year if he wants to give the next league a try, but all I can say is he's going to be a pretty good lawyer. He negotiated that move very well down on the other end.
Did he come to you for any advice as a Harvard law graduate?
Nah.
And a foul underneath as Butler is hacked. That's the 14th foul.
You only hope that you show him the way.
Bob Huggins has shown West Virginia the way early on with a 15-4 record, 4-2 in conference play, and a lot of people thought it would be a transition year, even though the Mountaineers return four double-figure scores a year ago. They're the only Big East team to do that. But when you have a new coach and taking over a system like John Beilein's that is so different than what you're used to.
Well, the changes have been relatively subtle, although, again, weight and condition program has gotten these guys from West Virginia visibly bigger, thicker, and the hope was that they'd get a little bit tougher. You know, obviously it's shown in their rebounding and it's shown in their defense, which is vastly improved on both fronts. But a lot of the offensive strategies, a lot of the offensive attack remains the same. You know, Bob Huggins pretty smart, not coming in there with a meat cleaver, just with a scalpel.
Shot clock at 8. Sapp from deep. Off the mark from 3, but Summers, playing with 3 personal fouls now, gets the rebound. West Virginia's won 15 in a row here at home, 3-0 in conference play this year at the Coliseum. Georgetown with an above 500 road record in Big East games. Rivers backdoor. Nice pass by Ewing.
Well, again, we talked about patience in the first half. And again, Georgetown running its offense with a great deal of patience, needs situation. And that second chance opportunity for Georgetown to get back and run its set, that puts a lot of pressure on the defense. It just wears you out chasing for 30 seconds. And the back door makes you very vulnerable to it.
And Smith fouled by Sapp. That's his 3rd, 5th on Georgetown. Well, 3 top 15 teams have already lost today. Georgetown, Patrick Ewing and Jeremiah Rivers hoping to keep it that way. Number 9 down 6 though right now.
Center 30 at 30 update. Good day for Tiger at the Buick. After a 66, he now has an 8-stroke lead. It's his 4th largest 54-hole lead ever. And for Woods, that's saying something. Good day for UConn basketball on the road at Indiana. Huskies with a 68-63 victory. All your highlights and details on SportsCenter after the X Games. And as always, stay current with ESPN News. Stay.
And UConn's women's team undefeated on the season, playing Notre Dame tomorrow night on ESPN2. West Virginia's women's team ranked 12th in the country, a winner earlier today over Georgetown. Coming up following the men's game between West Virginia and Georgetown, it's Winter X Games 12 with more action on the slope. Sean White in the snowboard superpipe men's elimination. Tucker Hibbert, no relation to Roy. And Blair Morgan in the snowmobile snowcross final and the snowboard big air final. That's tonight following this game on ESPN. You think that there's a snowmobile that would fit Roy Hibbert as you look at what's coming up in tonight's Winter X Games 12.
I suspect that in his future he could probably buy one custom made.
Hibbert still on the bench. Again, not a surprise, not for foul reasons. He's got 2. Only plays about half the game on average. Wanting his team to box out. And West Virginia, 5 of 12 at the free throw line in the game.
Again, 68% free throw shooting team coming into this game. But they've had some difficulty the last couple of games from that line. Speaking of difficulty.
Yeah, Ewing not ready for the pass, and then Sapp kicked it out of bounds. Correction, West Virginia 5 of 13 at the line. Right?
Communication breakdown. You got to be able to play the game, not do so much talking out there.
And turnovers by West Virginia, down 6 or by Georgetown rather, down 6 to West Virginia as the Hoyas commit their 6th team foul. That's going to go on Crawford, his 2nd personal. West Virginia's 15-game home winning streak and first place in the Big East at stake here at the Coliseum. With Len Elmore, I'm Dave Pasch. Georgetown 5-1 in Big East play. West Virginia 4-2. Louisville, after a win today, is at 5-2. Of course, a long way to go in the now 18-game Big East conference schedule.
The story of this game, West Virginia's ability to turn Georgetown over and get points off turnovers, as well as be able to shoot the 3, 7 of 15 thus far, almost 47%.
Ruoff's 3 in and out. Sapp got the block on Flowers as he tried to put it back up and in. And then Ewing is called for the foul. That's his first and the 7th on Georgetown. West Virginia's in the bonus.
A good hustle by both teams going after that loose ball. Strong, aggressive move by Patrick Ewing Jr. He gets both hands on the ball, so I'm not so sure that was a foul. Watch this. Both hands, does he get on the ball? And actually, it was the reach by Da'Sean Butler.
Wasn't a little bit of a shoulder block there by Ewing?
But that's how he positions to get the ball. When you're scrumming for the ball, you're able to use your body as long as, you know, it's not something that is so highly intentional and visible. And that time, he put both hands on the ball. It wasn't like he took an arm and held them off. But, you know, again, that's what happens when you're at home as well. West Virginia, many times we get the benefit of that call. Close call. But I like the aggressiveness of both teams going after it.
Hibbert back in, so Bob Huggins counters with Smalligan at 7 feet tall. See the numbers for Butler, who hit the front end of the 1-1. Missed the 2nd one. West Virginia, 6 of 15. Over the last 2 games, they're 17 of 43 at the foul line. And they beat Marshall, though. Can they beat Georgetown, despite shooting poorly?
Another back door.
Yep.
Now, West Virginia, when they get aggressive defensively, Georgetown using that aggression against them. Spreading the floor and able to step to the ball, make their man go above the line of ball, and then take them back door.
Austin Freeman with his 2nd field goal gets Georgetown back within 5. Midway through the 2nd half here in Morgantown. They rotate it around to the corner, and Nichols 3 is in and out. Ewing clears.
I can tell you one thing, the matchup zone from Georgetown has really slowed West Virginia down a bit. When they went to man, West Virginia able to capitalize on the mismatches.
And a West Virginia foul, 5th team foul on the Mountaineers. Well, you mentioned that this is for first place. Louisville at 5-2, Georgetown at 5-1. How about Pittsburgh now, 4-3 after losing at home to Rutgers?
Well, at one point, with the loss of Mike Cook and LeVance Fields and the success Pittsburgh was having, everybody obviously was heralding them. And now, losing to Rutgers at home puts them back in the pack.
John Thompson the 3rd, talking with Ed Corbett. There was some contact, but no foul. Hibbert and Smalligan battling inside, and now they call Smalligan for the foul. That's his 4th and the 6th on West Virginia.
And the official, Ed Corbett, signals it was a grab, and if Smalligan grabbed him, you know, you can't do that stuff. Let's take a look right here. In fact, he's got him around the shoulder, around the elbow. You've got to be able to use your forearm and not lock the guy like that, and Smalligan's just hurting his team. Although Bob Huggins wants him to be tough, wants him to use whatever's at his disposal to try to push Hibbert out. You got to use some discretion.
So now Joe Alexander on him, and Freeman gets down the lane for the dunk. They were so worried about Hibbert that time that Freeman had the lane.
Exactly.
And Georgetown is pulled within 3. Another nice assist for Patrick Ewing Jr. and the finish by Freeman.
And Dave, you hit the nail right on the head. It was the worry about Hibbert. You take a look right here at the front, at that spot. You see a man come down the lane. Hibbert has got Alexander blocked off, so he can't come and help. And the fact, take a look right here. When Alexander fronts, this is where the back door occurs, and there's no help whatsoever. Had Alexander been behind Hibbert, Hibbert either would have gotten the pass, or on the back door, Alexander would have been in great position to help out.
And how about Ewing? 4 assists in the game. Big Monday. means another doubleheader on ESPN, starting in the Big East with Louisville and UConn, followed by Oklahoma and Oklahoma State. Big Monday presented by Bud Light, part of Student Spirit Week presented by EAS on ESPN. And the two players for Connecticut suspended by Jim Calhoun, Jerome Dyson, a starter, and Doug Wiggins. But without those two guys, they went to Bloomington and beat number 8 Indiana today.
And that's going to do an awful lot for their confidence. And for Jim Calhoun's disciplinarian ways, guys know he mean business, and you know they recognize they hurt the team, and in some respects, team can work without him.
Here's Ruoff after the rebound by Flowers. No, boarded by Freeman. Georgetown with the ball, trailing by 3.
And just to show you that this game is going kind of the way we thought it, Georgetown 16 points in the paint, Hibbert and back doors, and West Virginia only 6. They've been thriving from beyond the arc.
Freeman tried to tie it, but he missed the 3. Here's Flowers on the kick out. Alexander giving it up. Alexander's only taken a couple of shots in this game. Another West Virginia miss, and the Hoyas with another opportunity to perhaps tie it on this possession.
And that was a change by Hibbert. Did a nice job of staying on his feet, getting a hand in Butler's face.
And again, Alexander giving up 6 inches, trying to guard Hibbert. Ewing's 3 off.
He had to go out there and play him.
Tapped out.
Ooh,
though,
that
by Wallace.
Like a carry. Got away with one there.
Ewing can't score anyway. Flowers outlets to Nichols. West Virginia's missed 7 straight shots, and a giveaway by the Mountaineers.
Uncharacteristic of Alex Ruoff, who always plays with intelligence, trying to throw a cross-court pass through the defense, through the number one defense in the Big East.
And in the country, in terms of Georgetown's field goal percentage defense, as Sapp scores and an opportunity to tie the game as Nichols commits the foul. His first and the 17 foul in Bob Huggins' squad.
And again, using the screen so well, nice job by Hibbert to peel off the defender. And now the help comes just a little bit too late. Darris Nichols doesn't get there in time, as Sapp had already left the floor.
How valuable a guy is Jessie Sapp for this Georgetown team? Leads him in assists, did that last year. 9 points per game. You look at what he's done in his career, really struggled against the Mountaineers, but he's got 9 points tonight. He's the second leading scorer for Georgetown in the game.
Well, he's feeling his oats. He came into this game averaging 12 points, 4 rebounds, and 5 assists over the last 2 games, shooting 50% from the field, and that's carried over here.
11-2 Georgetown run, and the Hoyas ranked 9th in the country have tied it at 41. Number 8 Indiana lost. Number 11 Wisconsin lost today. 15th ranked Ole Miss went down. 8 minutes to go here in Morgantown. Missoula around Macklin to an open Nichols. Buries a 3 for West Virginia.
Dave, when both these teams exercise patience in running their sets, spreading the floor, making the other guy defend, getting them out of position and finding open men, it's a beauty to behold, just like that back door. That's
yes,
basketball
sir.
Right there.
Great pass by Sapp to Summers. Now, a lot of people don't like the Princeton offense. They say it's too boring, but...
Well, this is modified. I mean, these guys are athletic enough where they can kind of break the mold a little bit. They can do some things that you wouldn't expect out of a, quote, Princeton team that maybe lacks the athleticism. But both of these teams have enough of it that they can throw it above the rim.
Tell you what, I can watch that all day, what we just saw in that last Georgetown possession.
And that's just great basketball, excellent team basketball. And see, that's one of the things that they can do, take people off the bounce on a straight take.
Georgetown back up 1 as Austin Freeman scores. Freshman from Mitchellville, Maryland, went to DeMatha. First DeMatha recruit at Georgetown in 20 years. As you see the points and the paint discrepancy. Georgetown plus 16. West Virginia continuing to rely on threes. And Darris Nichols puts the Mountaineers back up 2. And a timeout is called.
The difference is Georgetown wants to get into your heart, into the heart of the defense, into paint. And West Virginia doesn't mind living on the fringe, living on the edge.
That is 47-45 West Virginia. Now Georgetown played in Morgantown 2 years ago, their last visit to the Coliseum. Led by 11 in the first half, but surprise, surprise, started hitting threes. Kevin Pitznagel led the way with 23.
The legend, Pitznagel.
He was fun to watch at West Virginia. Great college player. Mountaineers beat an unranked Georgetown team that day. Right now they lead the ninth-ranked team in the country by two. They lead the conference in made threes. They have nine in this game.
That's what I mean by not minding living on the edge. That's how they score their points. They make you stretch your D to come out and guard them, and if you don't, they make you pay.
They're beating teams here at home by an average of 30 points per game. Their closest home win this year was a 9-point victory over St. John's. And they've won 15 in a row here in this building. They average 14 points per game more at home than they do on the road. And Bob Huggins knew when he took this job he'd have a terrific home court advantage.
West Virginia now in the 1-3-1. Georgetown taking a little bit of time to try to figure it out. Especially with Hibbert not in the game. Harder to throw over that zone.
Yeah, Macklin in the game for Hibbert. Wallace way off with that three-point attempt. But a nice save by Freeman. Rivers. Summers three, not there. Smith clears. Missoula guarded by Macklin. Here's Alexander. Alexander only 2 points in the game, but he's going to go to the foul line as Macklin is called for his first foul. 18 foul on Georgetown. West Virginia closing in on the 5-minute mark, leads it home by two.
You give a little love, and it all comes back to you.
You're gonna be remembered for the things that you say and do. You give a little love, and it all comes back to you.
You eating enough? You look a little thin.
Yeah, oh, that's a very mom question, but yeah. I'm eating enough.
I miss you, baby.
I miss you, too.
Love you.
Yeah, we love you.
We tell everyone about the relief work you're doing, you know?
Of course you do.
Welcome to a network that's bringing countries and families a little closer.
It's been a while now.
Cisco, welcome to the human network.
Now on Disney DVD and Blu-ray.
I'm your daughter.
Ha. Uh-uh.
Today.
No!
Teamwork.
Yeah!
Is the only game plan.
Oh! Spike wearing a tutu?
That is awesome!
Scar up and neck and baby, but that's alright with me. Look at this.
Put sparkles on it.
The game plan. Repeat on Disney DVD and Blu-ray High Def today.
Still some work to be done here in Morgantown. As we look at our game track, sponsored by TGI Fridays, West Virginia leading number 9, Georgetown by 2. Mountaineers leading the points off turnover battle. Points in the paint, though, dominated by Georgetown.
Well, the key for both these teams, obviously, West Virginia has to start making free throws. They've missed 9 so far, 6 of 15. And Georgetown, on the other hand, has to take care of the ball going down the stretch. 18 West Virginia points off turnovers.
And you see those little yellow rectangles at the bottom of your screen. Those indicate how many timeouts each team has left. 3 for Georgetown, 2 for West Virginia as Alexander hits the front end of the 1-1. Joe Alexander battling a groin injury, did not start tonight. Only 3 points in this game.
Although what I just said, both teams have to do, if they actually accomplish that, we might be here all night.
And out in Aspen, they'll have to wait, I guess. 4-point West Virginia lead, 5.5 to go. Roy Hibbert back into the game for Georgetown. And a timeout called by John Thompson as he saw his team in trouble there on that possession. First place is at stake in the Big East Conference in this game with Georgetown at 5-1. Its lone loss in conference play coming in Pittsburgh. Louisville to 5-2. West Virginia, Notre Dame, DePaul 4-2. And Pittsburgh losing at home to Rutgers. Cincinnati 4-3. Are there any surprises anymore in the Big East Conference left?
Well, not at this point in time. Certainly in the beginning when Cincinnati made themselves competitive. And, you know, a lot of people kind of put down Connecticut as a team that may have to wait till next year. But we saw them in Notre Dame come back from 21 and show that they can play. Obviously, the injury bug had a lot to do with the slow start for some teams like Louisville and even Pittsburgh, who suffered that loss today at home by Rutgers. But as far as surprises are concerned, that lineup you saw, that's going to shake up and turn around a couple of more times before this year is over. No doubt about it.
Yeah, John Thompson said as much. He said even if we win today and that gives us a little bit of separation, he still thinks that it is going to be tight till the end.
The road is harsh. Home is sweet.
Winner X Games 12 follows this
contest. Shoot the ball, big fella. Shoot the ball.
Kind of a half block by Wellington Smith.
That's because Hibbert, watch, he's trying to pass it. Shoot the ball. To the Freeman on the baseline. This is a 7'2" guy. Basket. Instead of putting up that hook, he wants to be more of a team player. This is what Hibbert needs more than anything else. A killer instinct. You got to be nasty.
That and Jeff Green.
I don't know. Except he probably would have whispered in his ear the same thing I did. Be nasty. Take over.
Green in the NBA with the Seattle Sonics, drafted fifth overall. Player of the year in the Big East last year. Roy Hibbert, the preseason player of the year this year. Tonight, Hibbert has 10 points, 8 rebounds, and a handful of blocks. Shot clock at 8 for West Virginia. Here's Alexander. Rising over Ewing and drawing a foul. Second on Ewing, ninth on Georgetown.
And again, that's an extraordinary athleticism. Joe Alexander can handle the ball. Watch the spin. Now watch the elevation right here. Patrick Ewing Jr. knew he couldn't do anything about it. Got him on the forearm. But Joe Alexander in the open floor for any front court player off the bounce is a load.
And really improved his foul shooting line this year at 83%.
Yeah, I was going to say, not shooting a three so well, but again, when he puts it on the floor, he's quick, he can jump, and he's got a nice touch from the mid-range.
Ewing out, Summers back in. West Virginia as a team, 8 of 18 at the foul line. They still beat Marshall the other night despite going 11 of 28 at the stripe. That was Marshall, though. This is number 9, Georgetown. And they've got a 5-point lead on the Hoyas, though, with 4.5 to go. Summers on the drive. Nice move by the sophomore from Baltimore.
Nice quick move, no hesitation. And that's what both these teams have to do now as we come down the stretch. Recognize shots, take advantage of them because you're not going to get many chances. Both these teams, excellent defensive teams.
Summers will have some inconsistencies in his game. Had 5 against Syracuse after he had 17 points and 11 rebounds last Saturday against Notre Dame. This game tonight, Wallace off the dribble. He has really struggled from the field, just 2 of 7, 4 points.
Alexander with that last turnover probably didn't realize he was head and shoulders past his man, had a pass to the basket.
Smith in the lane. They work it around to Smalligan.
Here's that patience.
Alexander says, forget that. Bombs away along 2, and West Virginia leads by 5.
But it was the patience, and Alexander went to triple threat, recognized that he had the smaller Austin Freeman over him, knew he could elevate above him.
Sapp can't elevate and hit a 3, and that's a foul on Ruoff. That's a on West Virginia. Alexander with the long 2. Big shot, makes it a 5-point West Virginia lead. All right, Sal, we're looking forward to seeing Tucker Hibbert up next. He's in the snowmobile snowcross event. There's Roy Hibbert. They're not related. Roy with four blocks in the game, 10 points, 8 rebounds. On the bench right now is Georgetown. Trails on the road by 5, ranked 9th in the country.
It may not be related, but they're kindred spirits trying to figure out how to eck this one out. Right? Tucker Hibbert wants to get that gold, and Roy Hibbert wants to get this win.
Gotta watch Snowmobile Snowcross coming up as part of Winter X Games 12 after we're done here in Morgantown. Wallace hits the front end of the 1-1, the 18 foul on West Virginia. A trio of top 15 teams, including number 8 Indiana, have been knocked off today. Will we have a fourth? Number 9 Georgetown trailing. And Ed Corbett and Pat Driscoll coming over to talk with Bob Huggins. Perhaps Huggins is arguing that Wallace is not the foul shooter, but it should be somebody else.
Couldn't even begin to tell you what they're arguing about.
And that's my only guess, because the foul happened before the break. Just making sure that it is indeed Jonathan Wallace that's the foul shooter. This is right before the break.
Yeah, it's Wallace.
Yeah. Maybe Bob Huggins was trying to say that it was Hibbert that was the free throw shooter.
No, but they called a foul on Ruoff again, reaching for the ball and kind of pulled Wallace down. I mean, that's unmistakable.
Wallace hit the first free throw. Don't forget Winter X Games 12 coming up in just a few minutes from Aspen. One more free throw for Jonathan Wallace, an 83% free throw shooter. He's perfect in Big East play, now 10 of 10 at the line.
Looking ahead on defense for Georgetown, West Virginia 5 of 10 from beyond the arc in this half. Georgetown has to extend its defense now.
Rivers will come in and replace Wallace here.
Going to have to keep the Mountaineers off balance. If they have to go back door, make them go back door. Too proficient from three in this half. And look at the way West Virginia spreads the floor. Not a soul in the paint. Unless he's a cutter.
Alexander, number 11, is the tallest guy on the floor for West Virginia at 6'8". Ewing, great play defensively with the steal, and he's fouled.
Well, we talked about extending the defense, and Patrick Ewing Jr., excellent anticipation. Right here, that pass, the angle of this pass might not have been the best. See, Nichols goes back door, and Ewing anticipates, gets above. That would have been a perfect time for Alexander to go back door.
And that's the fourth personal on Alexander. He and Smalligan both with 4. 19 foul on West Virginia. It's been a solid night for Ewing. 5 rebounds, 4 assists, 3 points. That steal. Unable to hit the first free throw. That was a shooting foul. So is a 2-shot foul here. Ewing, though, missed the first one.
Well, this is a young man that knows how to play the game. He's a senior, very experienced, but, you know, down the stretch, you've got to be able to hit free throws. But defensively, you know, I think that's his forte more than anything else because of the knowledge of the game, athleticism.
Georgetown 8 of 11 at the line, but that's better than West Virginia. The Mountaineers are 9 of 19. But West Virginia leads by 3, and DeJuan Summers is hurt. Summers hurt himself on that spin move by Butler. Butler also a little bit shaken up.
Butler might have stepped on his foot as he made that little jab step. And take a look. Yeah, that is painful right there.
Meanwhile, Ruoff commits his 4th. So 3 West Virginia, or make that, Crawford with his 3rd personal foul.
Now, it looks like he might have twisted it. What is it? His right foot, yeah, he twisted and tried to make that stop. At first, I thought that Butler might have stepped on it, but that was definitely a twist.
And Summers will go to the locker room. Foul was on Crawford for Georgetown, his 3rd, 10 team foul, so 2 free throws the rest of the way. And boy, that did not look good the way Summers went down. One timeout remaining for West Virginia, two for Georgetown.
Bob Huggins immediately tries to get Jamie Smalligan back in the ball game. Smalligan, with the ability to hit that three, has opened up the floor, forced Hibbert to come out and guard him. And that's the matchup that Bob Huggins wants. He's got to pull the big fella out of the middle so that West Virginia can work their offense.
Butler, a 64% free throw shooter, gets the first one. Smalligan in, and Flowers will go to the bench.
But that also cuts a different way, because down on the other end with Georgetown, you know, a little bit of movement gets Smalligan moving, and then quick post up by Hibbert. Smalligan with four fouls. Might be very hesitant to contest.
Don't forget, Winter X Games 12, snowboard, big air final, and more coming up next when we're done here. Still some work to do, though, with 2.5 to go. West Virginia leading by 5, needs a stop. Hibbert calling for it in the low post. Georgetown continues to work the perimeter.
You got to get Hibbert on the side of a shooter, because with Ewing, there's a double team. It's not the kind of shot you want from Roy Hibbert.
Freeman fouled, though, as he crashes the glass. That's the 10th team foul on West Virginia.
Not in crunch time. First thing Georgetown had to do was get Hibbert on the side of a shooter, because on Ewing's side, Ewing's man just dropped off and kind of fronted Hibbert, prevented the pass inside. So he changes sides, gets on the side of Jonathan Wallace, where West Virginia has to respect his shooting, and then you can enter the ball.
Ruoff commits the foul. That's his fourth. Alexander, Ruoff, and Smalligan are all on the floor right now for West Virginia, and they all have four personal fouls. Again, Bob Huggins with questions for our officiating crew. That was the 10th team foul. So it'll be two free throws here. Both teams in the double bonus. 5-point lead for West Virginia, trying to make it 16 straight home runs here at the Coliseum.
Once Roy Hibbert receives, he's got to understand, he's got the control now. If he puts it on the floor, if the West Virginia guys are coming, he's a good enough passer to find people, or he can just position himself to get a good shot. But that was a rush job right there. Freeman bailed him out with an excellent play. Or Ewing Jr. bailed him out.
Ewing gets the first free throw. Missed his previous two. Wallace to the bench. Rivers in. We're just a few minutes away from Winter X Games 12. Snowmobile snowcross, super tight men's elimination, and snowboard big air final up next from Aspen. Ewing gets them both, and it's a 3-point game. Approaching 2 minutes to go in the second half. Nichols on the drive. Ooh, maybe got away with a travel there.
So that's a matchup. Alexander backed it up. That's a matchup that West Virginia wants. Open floor in the middle right there. Alexander off the bounce.
And bricked that one. Butler got the rebound. And looked like Ewing got a piece of that shot.
He did.
Georgetown trying to get within one, or maybe tie it on this possession. Approaching a minute and a half remaining. Sapp on the drive. There with the tip, and Georgetown is down just one. Only one timeout left for West Virginia. Two for Georgetown. 1-point game with a minute to go.
Hibbert back on Smalligan. This matchup is a little bit closer right now. Alexander and Ewing Jr.
First place in the Big East on the line. Georgetown at 5-1. West Virginia 4-2. Great back door to Darris Nichols for the basket. And a timeout called by Georgetown. West Virginia by 3.
And how about the intelligence of West Virginia just picking Georgetown apart in many ways, finding the isolation, finding the matchup that benefits them most. First of all, here, Sapp with the long shot, and on the move, Hibbert gets open, and now just taking advantage. A little back screen. Rivers just victimized by the very athletic Darris Nichols. Smalligan sets a small back screen, Barely makes contact, but again, Nichols is a guy, a backcourt guy that you can lob to.
Each team with a timeout remaining, both teams in the double bonus. And Georgetown has attempted 16 threes tonight, made only three. I assume you want the offense to go through Hibbert, right?
Well, he would have to, but Hibbert has to be posted up on a side with a shooter, or you can get him on the move, start him on the high post, back screen, force his man to help and get him on the move as he floats down. But you got to get him open and force West Virginia to adjust.
They are roaring here at the Coliseum. Georgetown ball down three.
There's a high screen and there's a post up. Smalligan fronts him nicely.
Sapp, tough shot.
No
and the foul is before the shot on Butler. Still a two-shot foul because both teams are in the double bonus. Second personal on Butler.
Well, they did exactly what I thought they would. Try to get Hibbert on the move and then flash him into the post. But once again, we talked about it earlier. There always has to be a guy, particularly down the stretch, that's going to step up, take matters into his own hands when the opportunity presents itself, just like Jeff Green did last year.
Sapp, 75% free throw shooter, is 3 of 4 now at the line tonight. Wallace out, Rivers in. Sapp with 11 points, second leading scorer for Georgetown tonight, gets them both, and it's a one-point game again.
And I think these fans have to understand, Jessie Sapp from New York City, he's heard names before. That doesn't faze him.
Certainly didn't on that trip. And then a silly foul there on Jeremiah Rivers, his second. Nichols will shoot two, both teams in the double bonus, each team with one timeout remaining. Nichols is a 74% free throw shooter, but is 1 of 3 tonight. West Virginia is 11 of 21 as a team. They were 11 of 28 against Marshall the other night, but managed to win that game.
Both of these teams trying to steal a timeout without calling them. As John Thompson called his team over, and Bob Huggins said, well, why don't I call my team over? No one called a timeout.
No one fouled out. 15 straight home wins for West Virginia. 9-0 this season, 3-0 in conference play. And it seems like in the Big East, if you take care of business at home, you're going to be in the NCAA tournament, the Big East. Perhaps some blood on the jersey of Darris Nichols.
Now that's an opportunity for coaches maybe to call their guys over, but I guess they already got their instructions in on the little sleight of hand that occurred before.
Some extra time to think about it. Nichols with 15 points, but as mentioned, just 1 of 3 at the foul line in the game. If West Virginia makes them both, you're still looking for a 2 if you're Georgetown.
Yeah, if it comes up quickly, you take the 2. And then West Virginia, even though they're a pretty good free throw shooting team, they have struggled today. You know, I might take my chances extending the game.
This is the 124th consecutive game played by Darris Nichols. He'll leave West Virginia as the all-time leader in games played, but he missed the second free throw, and it's a 2-point game. Georgetown does have a timeout remaining. 20 seconds to go. Hoyas with the ball down 2. Wallace on the drive. 15 seconds left.
And Wallace is a 3-point threat.
10 seconds to go. Here's Sapp for 3. Got it! And Georgetown leads by 1. Still time left. 6 seconds to go, and the Mountaineers have a timeout. Huge shot by Jessie Sapp.
I think we foreshadowed it. We talked about the guy that has to step up and take it in his own hands, take matters into his hands, and Jessie Sapp has been that guy. Jesse's been on the spot several big opportunities for Georgetown. And here, when you think Wallace is the guy who's going to shoot the 3, Sapp off the bounce, raises up, just a straight man-to-man. Ruoff tries, but it's nothing but bottoms for Jessie Sapp.
And he was definitely behind the arc on that attempt. Jessie Sapp with a team leading 15 points. West Virginia with the ball. It's last time out. What's the play call if you're West Virginia after Georgetown hit its first 3 of the second half?
Well, if you're West Virginia, first thing you got to do is get it in bounds. Although, if I'm Georgetown, I might drop back 3 quarters not a full court situation, because if you miss the steal or you try for a steal and they get a running start, you got an opportunity to get advantage break situation. But really what it comes down to is being able to spread the floor once again. You got a number of guys who can take Georgetown players off the bounce in an isolation, whether it's Nichols, whether it's Alexander, whether it's Ruoff.
Don't forget, Winter X Games 12 coming up next. Snowboard Big Air Final, Snowmobile Snowcross Final, and more from Aspen. 6.2 left here in Morgantown. West Virginia with the ball, trailing by one.
And there is enough time to get one quick high screen. Once again, if you can rush the ball up the floor. But that's all you have. Then it's going to be one-on-one.
Pat Driscoll telling the Georgetown players to head back to the bench and take their seats. There was some perspiration on the floor. And Ed Hightower kindly helping out there with the towel.
Any long pass in the air, if I'm the Georgetown players, I go after it like a cornerback or a free safety goes after a pass.
Alexander to Nichols. 4 seconds left.
There's a high screen.
Nichols with two. On the drive, Butler blocked! And the game's over! Bob Huggins wants him to count the basket, but no! Huggins can't believe the call. He wanted goaltending. But Georgetown has won the game! What a block! Patrick Ewing came over and swatted Da'Sean Butler's shot at the buzzer.
Man, ending on one of the toughest calls in the game. West Virginia got what they wanted. Penetration to the basket, an opportunity. We'll take a look right here. It's going to be hard to tell. Oh, that looked like a good block. I'm not sure. Finger roll. Look at the finger roll right there. Oh, man, it might have just reached the apex. That is so difficult to call right there. You can't really tell from that angle. Can't really tell from that angle. That's usually the official out front. That's who Bob Huggins went to immediately. Ed Hightower, the guy out at the top, usually makes that call.
Georgetown wins it. Patrick Ewing Jr., much like his father used to do when he was here at Georgetown, swatting away a game-winning attempt by Da'Sean Butler to snap West Virginia's 15-game home winning streak. Winter X Games 12 is next for Len Elmore, our entire crew on Dave.